Hi, everybody, and welcome to my first tutorial for organizational behavior. So I hope this helps. It's just going to be a short tutorial about one particular model that we've already talked about in class, and I wanted to go over with it with you just one more time, hitting on some of the key points and then answering those three questions that you may see coming up on a future exam. So today's model that we're talking about is Team Effectiveness Model, and we talked about this in Chapter 8 of Week 2 regarding team dynamics. And so the first thing that I wanted to make sure that we understood is that there is, in a very real sense, there is this idea that the environment that surrounds our team, whether that's in the organization or outside the organization for that matter, has an effect on how our team interacts, behaves, and responds, not only internally but also externally. So we have to consider this open systems thinking perspective when we're looking at teams. And again, this is something that I would want you to think through when you have the opportunity to build your own teams, or if you are a part of a team and you are the team lead, or even if you're not the team lead and you're looking at ways to effectively work within the team. These are some things that I want you to think about, and it's stuff that I think about whenever I have the opportunity to build a team or I'm working on a team. So again, the first thing we want to consider is the idea that the environment has a key role in how our teams operate. The next thing I want to draw your attention to is design and how we put together our teams. And so I'm going to walk through with you a couple things to keep your mind sharp when you have that opportunity to build your own teams. And the first thing that I want you to think about is the idea that smaller teams are better. What we mean by that is we don't want our teams to be too large, into the double digits in sense. There's a lot of studies out there that would indicate that the smaller the team, single digit members within a team make that team more effective, speeds up the time it takes to build cohesion and trust. They also respond better to crisis when they're in a smaller team. And so when we're looking at building our smaller teams, there's this idea of the five C's and the composition of our teams. And so these are really important for us to think about when we're putting our teams together. That's why it's called the five C's, or five composition pieces. The one is cooperate. How well do we think the team will cooperate together? And we're talking about the internal pieces here. How well will they coordinate tasks and responsibilities? How well will they communicate? And this spills outside the team as well, we'll see in a little bit. But how well are they going to communicate with each other as a team? How are they going to work through conflict? We know that whenever people get together and they form teams or they form groups, there will always be conflict. Because we're people, there's always going to be conflict, and the perspective that people bring to the team in regards to conflict. And so how are they going to handle conflict? How are they going to process it? And how will they plan to come out the other side of it stronger as a team? The last thing that you want to consider is comfort. And I'm not talking about the comforts of life necessarily, but I'm also talking about, will you consider putting a person on the team who cares about the comfort of that team or the environment that that team is in emotionally, cognitively, and will take some steps towards making sure that barriers and walls are being lowered and are constantly made aware of? And so the five C's become really important when we build our teams. The other thing that we talked about was this idea of diversity. And not just ethnic and background diversity, which is massively important, but we're also talking about a diversity of skills, a diversity of knowledge, and a diversity of perspective, because you don't want what I would call a monochromatic team where everyone thinks the same, everyone has the same skills, everyone has the same knowledge, and everyone has the same perspective, because now you're really limiting what that team can do, and you're also limiting the growth potential of members in that team when you keep things monochromatic, as I would say. And so when we look at building teams, we want to keep these ideas in place that there's the five C's. There's also a diversity in what we do. The next thing I want to bring to your attention is the idea of states, okay? And what I mean by that, or what the text means by that, is this. So What we mean by states is the norms, and norms are how the team behaves. What are the rules that the teams come up with to govern their activity? What are the expectations that people on the team have, not only of each other, not only of themselves, but of the team as a whole? And what expectations does the team have of the organization? These things are items that need to be talked through as the team begins their forming stage in the five-stage model of team development. These are the things that are foundational. They set the rules. They set the game for the rest of the time that the team is together, and they're massively important. Along with that, and what I would call probably the most important pillar of any team construction, any team development, is the idea of trust. And trust really falls into two categories. One is cognitive and one is emotional. And what we mean by cognitive, or what I mean by cognitive, is the idea that we have a style of trust called calculus trust, and it means exactly what you would think. It's this idea that's very foundational to the building of trust. And it's we begin making calculations. We begin cognitively thinking our way through, can this situation, can this team, can that individual be trusted? Can I be sure that they will act on what they know? Can I be sure that they will follow through on what they say they're going to do? It's very foundational. It's also very fragile. And it's very important that we move from calculus-based trust to a knowledge-based trust. And what I mean by knowledge-based trust is the idea of predictability. Will this person do what they do in almost every situation? Or are they going to change? Are they going to flip-flop? Can I predict with a fair degree of accuracy how certain people are going to think and behave? That becomes the knowledge-based trust. And as we begin to grow in this kind of trust, the walls begin to come down just a tiny bit. And also, these things apply to us as individuals in the team as well, because those people in our team will be doing the exact same thing to us. They'll be going through a calculus-based trust, and then they'll be moving on to a knowledge-based trust. The third level of this trust is identification. And what we mean by this is we actually start, and this is where the emotional piece gets into play, because we start talking more about values and mental models, meaning perspectives, frames that we look at the world through. And so we begin to identify really what the person will tolerate, what they won't tolerate, what's important to them, what's non-negotiable, what is negotiable, and we begin operating in that realm. Now, the important thing to remember about trust is that it's fragile and it can break, and in most cases, when trust is broken, we go right back to the calculus-based trust, and we have to work through the building up of trust again through knowledge and identification. So that's why I call it cognitive and emotional elements in this idea of trust. The other thing I wanted to highlight for you is the idea of processes. And now processes are what we call both internal and external. And so what I mean by internal is, are those tasks and experiences that the teams go through, is it going to build them up? Is it going to make them stronger? Or does it have the potential to tear them apart? And this is what I talked about earlier in regards to making sure that when we're setting up our teams in those five C's, we absolutely address the issue of conflict. We have to. It's massively important because it becomes part of the glue, part of the cohesion for the team. So the processes are not only external, but they're internal, and these are probably more important than the external pieces. How is the team going to tackle tasks, and how are they going to process experiences? The other piece to this is what I would call external. And so how is the team going to communicate? And this is not only just internally, although that's important. This kind of communication is external. How are they going to communicate to the rest of the organization? How are they going to communicate to other teams or other working groups? Probably more importantly, how are they going to communicate and present themselves to senior management? That's massively important. Then there's the collaborative piece. How well will this team work with other teams? How well will this team work with other parts of industry or the marketplace? That's massively important, because we know that if collaboration increases, then the chance of success can also increase. Collaboration is not a magic bullet. It's not a magic pill. It won't make everything work better, but when it's done correctly, it will massively ensure the success of the team. Then the other thing that we talk about in regards to external is an environmental scan. And what we mean by that is, how does the team view their competition? How does the team view changes in technology? How does the team view the marketplace that they are in? And so they'll begin to take an environmental scan of the external environment that they're in. And that will include competition from even rival companies. It may even be competition from other teams or groups within the organization. It will certainly include technology and the impact that technology has on what they will do and their plans and their goals moving forward as a team. And also the marketplace and how the marketplace is responding to changes in its environment. Because remember, this is an open systems perspective. And if there are changes in the external marketplace, that's going to have an effect on the team. Thirdly, this is where we would start talking about the 5-stage model of team development. And I'll do that in another tutorial. But this is where we would begin focusing on how the team progresses together in their experiences together. Okay. But I'll cover that in another tutorial. So I'm just going to leave that for now. And so putting all this together, we would see that the design absolutely has an effect on the states or the norms, the behaviors of the team itself. And it also is going to have an effect on the processes and what the team does together to process both tasks and experiences internally, but also their external environment. And so again, designing the team correctly, or putting a lot of thought and a lot of work into designing the team correctly, will go a long ways in making sure that norms, behaviors, trust is growing in a positive direction, and that the processes being used are being leveraged in such a way that it just enhances the states. Now, when we couple the states together with processes, that's when we start looking at the effectiveness of the team. And when we define effectiveness for teamwork or for collaborative work, that definition is the effectiveness, does it benefit the organization? Does it benefit the team members themselves? And does it actually accomplish the mandate that the team has been put together for in the first place? Because remember, in a previous lecture, we talked about efficiency and effectiveness. One person can be efficient with their time and their resources and what they do with those, but it's an entirely different thing to become effective with time and resources and now people. And so that's why teamwork is sometimes really hard. That's why collaboration and cooperation is really hard, because we've brought in that third element called people. And teams are most effective when they begin considering outcomes for the organization, and of course outcomes for themselves. And that can be broken into two pieces as well: outcomes for the team, outcomes for members in the team, as well as did they actually meet the goals and the mandate that they were put together for. So that breaks down the team effectiveness model for you. I hope this helps. Please feel free to rewind this and watch it over and over and over again. And so I'm going to address the three questions. What's the name of this model? The name of this model is what we call a team effectiveness model. And how? What kind of concept does this model display for us? The concept of this model helps us understand that when we put teams together, the external environment is important because it has an effect. The internal environment is important because it has an effect. So in essence, we're concerned about open systems thinking. That's the concept. The practical piece to this is that when we have an opportunity to build a team, we want to put some solid effort and thinking processes into the design of the team, the composition, of the team, the skills and the knowledge, the backgrounds, the perspectives. All of that is important when we put teams together, but that's not the only thing you need to consider. You also need to consider, how will the team work out, how it will behave. So in essence, will it produce a team charter for the team to begin navigating through conflict and navigating through success? And then there's got to be some processes put in for team development, and what and how will that be accomplished? And ultimately, will the team be effective? And will it meet its mandate? Will it satisfy the needs of not only the team members and the team itself, but will it satisfy the needs of the organization? So there's the team effectiveness model. I hope this helps. Stay tuned for the next tutorial. It'll be coming out in a very short time. Take care.